So we've got a short presentation to deliver to you this evening, which will be given by myself and Ken Smith of Environment Health, and his colleague Victoria Chatterton, who is involved in the measurement of air quality on my own. Well, that receives lots of questions as well. So presentation, as we've done before, if you want to ask questions during the presentation, please do so. We'll wait until the end. We'll have a discussion at the end of our presentation as well. So what we're going to cover briefly is I'm going to give you a strategic overview of air quality. It's a timely topic of issue. You'll be aware that the government launched their plan in July. I'm going to give you some details about that. I want to explain how Wirral measures air quality, what we do, who we report to, etc. We want to give you an update on what is happening across the city region. Things are changing and happening in that respect, and our position on across the region. Mentioned the government's plan, we're going to give you details about what that entails and what opportunities it gives us, access to funding, etc. And we'll then talk about opportunities and issues that relate to air quality moving forward. So in terms of strategic overview, there's quite a lot of bullet points over, you can see them there, we'll just go through them. As I said, the government launched its plan for improving air quality in the UK in July. It was a culmination of a considerable period of consultation and legal challenge, unless it's out. The plan includes a headline, as you all I'm sure, for the summer, of ending the sale of diesel and petrol cars by 2040. That was the headline long-term objective. However, there's a range of short and medium-term objectives on addressing most polluted locations in the UK. The government requires local authorities to take action to establish what are called clean air zones or CASs at such locations. I have to say that that doesn't apply to anywhere in the Merseyside region here. Across the region, there are 11 declared air quality management areas for locations that will exceed or likely to exceed legal levels for nitrogen oxide, nitrogen dioxide levels, sorry. And there are 543 of these so-called areas in the UK, in England. Again, I'll stress none are in Wirral. We have not had to declare such an area for our authority. Local authorities are required by statute to explain how that works to you in more detail to measure assess air quality. Therefore, Wirral has established a measuring arrangement, which I'm going to explain the resources we have for that. We report air quality measures on an annual basis to DEFRA, and they review our submission and give us comments. And historically, we have always received positive feedback in terms of our structure, the adequacy of it, and the measurements being below the threshold. So before we go on to how we measure air quality, just a quick overview of what our main points. Air pollution is a mixture of particles and gases that have an effect on human health. The government has set statutory levels for 7 pollutants. The main two that concern us that we're presenting tonight are on particle matter and nitrogen dioxide, as they're most concerned. Much of particulate matter in urban environments, as you'd expect, come from traffic sources. Transport is also a major contributor to nitrogen dioxide emissions, particularly from diesel-powered cars, light-duty vehicles such as cars and vans. And it's interesting to note that in the years since 2000, the 16 years that have occurred, diesel cars have increased from 3.2 million to over 12 million in the UK. A statistic from Public Health England, using various amounts of modelling techniques, estimate that in Wirral, particulate matter contributes potentially to 166 approximately premature deaths per year. However, on Wirral, as you'll hear, a comparison between 2010 and 2015 is that basically nitrogen dioxide levels are diminishing. They are reducing here, and they are below the national threshold. In terms of the threshold, apologies if this is a slightly busy slide. This is taken from the submission we sent to DEFRA. These are the measurements first two are the key ones for us, nitrogen dioxide and particulate matter. There is an annual mean, because we measure this on an ongoing basis, which again we'll hear from. Basically, the tolerance is there in terms of 40 micrograms per cubic meter of air, and that's what we measure against. The others are measured, or been measured in the past, but they are low and insignificant at the moment, so we don't measure them in the same way that we do for nitrogen dioxide and particulate matter. I'll hand over to my colleague. Slightly wider variety of things.
stop the traffic, idling engines, pumping out pollutants. So the council decisions are influencing the 166 deaths that we have, and there's 40,000, over 40,000 deaths in this country. So this is probably, if this is probably the most important agenda item that the Environment Committee has, dare I say.
Thank you for that, Chair. Certainly, there are no real surprises. There's a couple of things that I'll talk about in a moment, but where we see high volumes of traffic, the stationary for long periods of time, we would expect higher levels. Absolutely. And some of the measures that we're thinking about taking as well might address some of that, some of those concerns about idling. The latest measurements that we have overall show that the levels are going down nationally. I think 5-year period between 2010 and 2015, it was a 17% decrease in levels of nitrogen oxides. But in small localised areas, there are still problems around the country, and it's important that we carry on monitoring to make sure that they are not on the rise. I mentioned one road that I wanted to speak on a little bit more. In 2016, one site exceeded the national air quality objective threshold, and that was Wallasey Road in Liskeard. This was following complaints about idling taxis at the taxi rank, whilst it didn't fit in with the objectives of measuring the house facades or schools or hospitals. We've carried out monitoring there to see if that is a particular problem. And again, it's probably not surprising that due to perhaps idling on the taxi rank, those are elevated levels. I'm going to talk a little bit more later on about what we're trying to do to address that. Because there aren't residences there, that hasn't been regarded as relevant exposure, so we've not been asked to put air quality management area in place at that location. Council has established an air quality liaison group, and that is where officers from planning, traffic and transportation, sustainability, environmental health and public health meet together to look at air quality, and as time goes on, to give more scrutiny to this annual review, to make sure that we're looking in the right places, that we're not missing anything, and we're behaving properly.
Can I ask a question about Singleton Avenue? You've got a school there.
Maybe working with the public more to see what we can do to
when they're in the yard. That's why I'm asking about it.
Sorry, can I just add what Christine said? I mean, probably the worst school in the whole authority is involved in this car.
Yeah.
Because the playground is almost on the road, and you know, quite often it must be even there.
Yeah.
I always think, oh my goodness, it must be really polluted because there's cars constantly going round there and stopping, and what does it everything really? And so, you know, there must be something to I know they put up some barriers, but they're not great barriers there. But
radical solution. And I think, you know, I'm fed up with hearing, you know, the cuts, cuts, cuts. And they are savage, and they are affecting us all. But it's like road safety. We spend, as a council, we spend a lot of money putting the road pumps in, speed pumps, slows cars down, adds to pollution. We spent a lot of money. In our park is a classic. It was a roundabout. Now, years ago, we spent a lot of money taking away the roundabouts, putting traffic lights in, cost a fortune. Now, if we're going to handle air pollution seriously as a council, we've got to look at these things. And I mean, and we've now got, years ago when we took away the roundabouts and we put the traffic lights in, we didn't have the technology then to tell us, as stark as it is now, how bad the air quality is and how many people are dying. And we've talked, Christina's talked about the children, I mentioned the hospital. So as a council and as a committee, this committee, and it's the same with the committee I chair, we've got to look at how we can best tackle this. And if it means a committee making a recommendation to Cabinet that we need to put more money into certain departments if we're going to achieve the outcomes that we want, as uncomfortable as it is for council, I think as committees, if we're going to do our job properly, and that goes for all the committees, we've got to make some difficult decisions. And if we're going to do scrutiny and do it properly, we've got to make, perhaps, I'm not prejudging here, but if we've got to make recommendations as committees, which makes uncomfortable reading for Cabinet, I think we've got to look at it. You know, the bumps, when all this came out, we said, well, we've got to go around the country ripping up the bumps. But even if we've got to then make the case to central government that councils desperately, desperately need more money, we need to do it. Thank you.
Chair, just to clarify, we've got about 4 or 5 slides to get through here, so Kevin's obviously both on very much
there. Well, you did say, Mike, if there's any questions, you did.
Not to move into the debate,
accessing, and that was a genuine question, I wasn't being particularly I wanted to know where the government was putting funding in. Are we as a council, can this committee be reassured that we as a council are doing our utmost to get as much of that 255 million as we possibly can?
The answer is yes. That's the question. The statistics about the region and these clear air zones, they're going to be further ahead of the compelling case. And it's not that I'm quite a compelling case, but they're always going to be further ahead of it.
But we're trying to get that funding, Mike.
Yeah. So there's a travel have and will continue to be there until it's out of hand. So.
Can I ask, you know, when you talk about taking away speedballs and stuff to make the cars go faster?
I was highlighting the issue.
Is there any you looking into road safety in these kind of things?
Well, I said, because I've been
trying to get
specified that the sort of things you might apply for to do with this money is to remove traffic safety schemes and improve junctions. That wasn't in the plan. That's sort of thing.
We do work closely with the levels in transportation. It's obviously important that we don't compromise road safety at the same time as promoting air quality. Sometimes there is a synergy. So, for example, steady, low-speed driving is good for air quality. So some of the traffic safety measures aren't necessarily all bad for air quality. The example we're all aware of is kind of speeding up in between, slowing down in between, which is bad. Some councils are looking at encouraging providing services, but that's an ongoing discussion. So, over the last 5 years, levels of nitrogen dioxide have fallen across Wirral. We don't have any air quality management areas. However, we do have a number of policies across the council in many teams that do impact on air quality. So, for example, just quickly, because I detailed knowledge of all of these, but we adopted the City Region's Transport Growth Plan, and that looks at promoting effective and sustainable transport networks. It's not about being able to get out of cars if there's no buses, but actual trains. We've established an electric vehicle strategy to try and speed up the uptake of electric vehicles and the infrastructure associated with it. We've got a long-standing commitment to Climate Local and we established a Cool Rural Climate Change strategy. This strategy focuses on reducing climate pollution. Go Cycle is offered at 12 of our railway stations, which is offers to passengers an alternative mode of transport for their on the journey.
Can I just add on your Go Cycle from, if I understood it right, last night at the integrated transport meeting? You have to return your cycle to the station you got it from because it's theft, and therefore they're not really used very much, and it's not really a thing that would aid anti-pollution because you've got to use your car to get there, possibly to pick up the bike to get it because you've got to get it back. So I don't think that's a very useful example.
Thank you. Those comments back to colleagues in there.
But I have another question. Do we still have different levels of car tax, I don't know, of car tax for different cars? Because diesel and everybody got it very cheap.
It's not the other way
around. Is it the other way around now? Well, that's sort of there. I'm quite pleased about that.
During 2016, an extra additional 3 kilometres of cycle paths were provided. With taxi licensing, the older vehicles, both hackney carriages and private hire, subject to an additional MOT with an emissions test, so that's every 6 months rather than every year. In partnership with Mersey Travel, we've approved a network of bus and rail-based park and ride schemes, and 12 of the borough's train stations now
So you've heard the position on the bill. Yeah, it's we have got issues compared to our regional colleagues or national colleagues even. Just geographically being in Lincolnshire, etc. Means we just haven't got the sort of issues that inner city Liverpool or Seven have got. But nonetheless, we have issues. And we also have issues in the future that we need to make sure don't adverse effects air quality management. So everything to do, you know, there are key things within the world plan about how many houses we're going to build or how much investment we're going to go into small and medium enterprises or even investment, etc. Tourism. These issues can affect our delicate balance in terms of air quality moving forward. So we're preparing a strategic review of air quality in depth about what we're doing. So we're going to take Council Mosbrough's issue about the fledgling train bike system, which has got issues. But nonetheless, they're aligned with alternative modes of transport, etc. And they can be improved. So the transport scheme obviously is something that is moving forward and is long term. The things like fledgling is obviously e-vehicles and charging for vehicles. So if we can get things into planning about making sure that there are connection built into new houses or new estates or new developments, that's the sort of thing that we want to move forward on in the future. So what I want to make the board council aware is that yes, it's not very fault, but nonetheless it's there to use and people are using it, so I understand.
So
if
we can only use it to go back to where you got it from.
Well, that's a train, isn't it? So you go back to the train to your journey. So for instance, if you call the train to West Kirby, you go through the line and come back. That's how people do it, West Kirby.
Yes. That's why it's not working.
Okay. Well, you know, if it's working in other cities like London, you can adopt that by somewhere else. We need to pass them on, we need to pass them on.
Apparently we started letting you drop them off along the route, but you can't do that because people are scurrying. That's what we were told last night. But the major hub is Booth anyway, which is outside the borough. You may just have to pick them up. If you get them on West Kirby, you put them back on West Kirby, so anything we do by way of a ride, we're going to be halfway back on the and that was a major problem for us at left there.
Yeah, we'll feed them back, as Ken said. In terms of the Metro Mayor, obviously it's early days with him. He's developing his company plan. Part of it is an action on air quality, and we'll work with that and work with him on regional target setting. The public health are updating their joint strategic needs assessment for rural air quality. That's going to be ready this calendar year. Modelling on those contributory deaths needs to be taken with some qualification. We can give more detail about that, I'm sure, Ken, about how that works. Certainly, reading and obviously any implication in that is obviously not something we want to attack and address. But we are certainly lower regionally and nationally in those figures. And something else we're considering is enforcing against vehicles idling. We're exploring the powers we've got under the road traffic emissions regulations legislation to do that. So we're considering how that would be developed into our enforcement.